Good morning. Welcome. What a beautiful spring day to be in here for worship today. I'm going to start from Psalm 139 today. We're going to jump in right in the middle here. This is a psalm of David. He said, "For you created me in my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I'm fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful, and I know that full well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in the secret place, when I was woven together in the depths of the earth. Your eyes saw my unformed body. All the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came to be. How precious to me are your thoughts, O God. How vast is the sum of them. Were I to count them, they would outnumber the grains of sand. When I awake, I am still with you." And then jumping down to the end, "Search me, O God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there's any offensive way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting." Amen. Let's do that. Lord, we come to worship you today. God, thank you that you created us and gave us life and you formed us together. And so, Lord, we come and worship today. God, thank you for your what you want to do. Thank you for what you're doing in our nation. And God, we pray for more. And so, God, meet us here today. Our hearts are on your altar on this local mission week. God, how can we be your hands extended right here in our own backyard? God, what would you ask of us to be the feet and the hands of Jesus? God, speak to us today, we pray, in Jesus' wonderful, powerful name. Amen. Amen. Why don't you stand this morning? Let's worship the Lord together. Amen.
Ready to give him praise today? Is he worthy? Amen. He is worthy. Let's sing it to him.
Mighty in battle, perfect in love, awesome in wonder, faithful and just, matchless in mercy, wisdom and strength. You can be trusted in all of your ways. Oh, you are holy, oh, King of glory, oh, all of heaven and earth cry out. Unto your name, glory and honor, unto your name, wisdom and power, unto
today, Lord. We glorify your name. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen.
To do.
Lord, you said greater things, Lord. Greater things. Jesus, you said greater things we do. Do you believe that, church? I believe it. I don't know. Some maybe faith needs to rise up in you today, but I believe that God's word is true. He is true. Amen. Let's have some faith rise up in us today. Hallelujah. Lord, we know you can do great things. Hallelujah. 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 Lord, we know you're the greatest of all, Lord God, our healer. That one line in that song has been my prayer this week. Lord, pour it out. Pour it out, Lord.
Great is your faithfulness.
never fails. You are faithful. You're faithful. How many know he's faithful today? As I look around and I see testimonies of faithfulness. Just this year, amen, right? God is faithful. He is your confidence. He won't fail you, amen? He won't lift us. He won't leave us. He'll never forsake us. You don't fail us, Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You know, as so much we've heard about revival this week, and I just glorify your name, Lord. Thank you that you haven't forgotten us, Lord. That you are so great and you're so mighty. Lord, we thank you, Lord. If you need prayer today, I don't know what it's for, but I just sense there's breakthrough today for some of you. There is breakthrough for some of you today. Would encourage you right now, if you need prayer today, we want to believe with you, want to stand with you, want to pray for you as we continue to worship. How many said he did it for me and he can do it again? Amen. He can. Hallelujah. As we continue to worship, would you come? We're going to declare his name above all names today.
You are love.
Somebody lift your voice today. He is great. Lord, all the earth, all this church, we lift your voice on high, oh God. You are worthy, Lord God. There is none like you. Come on, church, use your own voice, not just the words of a song. We declare it, Lord, with our own lips, with our own praise. You are great and mighty. There is none like you, Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Great are you, Lord. Great are you, Lord. We lift our voice.
Oh, we bless your name, God. We lift our voice with those around the world today, God. Every tribe and tongue and nation would exalt the name of the Lord today, God. We bless you. Faithful God, soon coming King. Oh, God, we long for your appearing. But, Lord, until then, we're going to occupy. We're going to be your hands and feet, Lord. We're going to lift up your name. We're going to follow you. And so, God, we're all in today. God, we're on your altar today. You get all of us, Lord, our hopes and our dreams, our passions, our finances, our time, our influence. God, we trust you with everything. We trust you. You're a good Father. We bless your name. And so, God, that's our prayer on this local missions week. God, we're all in. You can have us. Use us for your glory. God, we're your currency. Spend us as you desire. And so, God, we love you today. We give you praise today. God, have your way in our hearts and lives today. Challenge us, stir us, call us out. God, have your way, we pray. We love you. We give you praise. None like you, King Jesus. We bless your name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 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 You can be seated this morning. Praise the name of the Lord. Amen. Thank you, worship team. Amen. Well, thanks for being in the house of the Lord today. It's a great month we've got going on, our missions month, and so appreciate you all your work you've already done. Did Network of Nations banquet just a couple week and a half ago, and then last week we had Teen Challenge in as we looked at our home missions, what God's doing in America. Today is our local missions emphasis, so thank you so much for that. Part of this week is what can you do locally, and so we got a couple colleges right in our backyard. Maybe you've heard there's been some moves of God in some of the colleges of our nation these last couple of weeks, and everybody's talking about that. What's God going to do in our college campuses? It just happens. That this Thursday is a big national day. This was actually around before this was started to happen the last couple of weeks, but it's the Collegiate Day of Prayer, and they're asking for believers just to pray for their college campuses. Like I said, this was already set and in the works, and so there's a website, Collegiate Day of Prayer, how about that, .org, and you can go there, and you just happen to have a couple colleges right in your backyard, NIU, just a few miles away over in DeKalb, Kishwaukee, just down the road. And so this Thursday, people all over the nation will be praying for their local colleges. And so we want you to be a part of that. This is part of local missions. This is part of your backyard. We went over there a week and a half ago and fed a bunch of internationals. And this is a week to follow up with that. So I encourage you, pray for NIU and for Kishwaukee College. You can pray for them every day. But there's a bunch of people going to be praying for the colleges of our nation this Thursday. So it's the collegiatedayofprayer.org. You can go on there. You can register. You can see other people that are praying for their colleges. It's kind of nice to know you're not the only one, right? That's one of the lies of the enemy. You're the only one. But you're not the only one. And so encourage you to be a part of that this Thursday, Collegiate Day of Prayer. Also, this Thursday is our men's lunch out at Portillo's at noon. So come hang out with the guys this Thursday, lunch at Portillo's at noon. This is our, like I said before, this is our missions month. We had Teen Challenge in. We've already done that. We try to give you things that you could be doing. We're going to do Meals on Wheels in March. We deliver one of the Sycamore routes. So there's a calendar out in the back table, and you can volunteer to do that. It takes about an hour or so. You don't have to cook or wash dishes. All you do is pick up and knock and smile and be a friendly face. If you got kids, take your kids. Go with somebody else. Don't do it by yourself. And it's just a great just entry-level ministry, right? It's super easy. Someone else has already done all the work, but you're the hands and feet that get it there. So if you need more information about that, like I said, it takes about an hour from 11-ish to noon-ish. And so there's a sign-up sheet in the back of that, a calendar for the days that we're signing up for. So that's one way that you could be involved as a part of that. What else we got going on? Oh, We Care Baby Bottles. We had those out last week. We Care Crisis Pregnancy Center is right over in DeKalb. We have people here who volunteer weekly and monthly for that. And that's part of your faith promise giving is we give to them every month. But once a year, they hand out baby bottles. Miss Sonia has one. Wave that high there for us. There's a basket of those in the back. And so grab one of those on your way out today if you didn't get one last week. Take it home. That's just a prayer reminder. Be praying for We Care. over this coming month, and then also just fill it up with some change and a check and some cash, and we were able to support We Care Pregnancy Center, bringing them back in the month, and we'll get them all to them and just be a nice financial boost for them as they head into spring here. And so we love We Care. Once again, that's part of your faith promise giving that we give every month, so we're able to be a part of that. Next Sunday is our World Mission Sunday. We got the Bales coming. They're in Lesotho, way down in South Africa, and they're going to be with us as we lift up our eyes on the world. What's God doing around the world? So we'll be doing that next Sunday. Next Sunday is also our Faith Promise Sunday. I know some of you are newer to our church, but kind of one of the ways that we do missions is called Faith Promise. These are there's some flyers on the back table that explains it a little bit more than I'm going to explain it today. But if you're brand new, maybe grab one of those. Basically, what we do is we as a church adopt missionaries and causes that we are going to do together. And so we kind of put all our money in one big pot, and we're able to fund missions and do all of that. And so there's also another flyer. I think it's in the bulletin today, or there's some more on the back table also. It just has a list. This is where our missions money goes. Your missions money goes every month. We're Teen Challenge and the inner city, church planning. I'm not going to read all of these, but We Care, Never Going to Nations, and Sweden, and France, and Global University, Guatemala, Nicaragua, South Africa, all sorts of things that you that we're able to do together. We do that through the Faith Promise. This is what I feel God directing me to give to missions monthly over this next 12 months, and then we'll do that next Sunday. You can fill out a card. This is what, and I'm telling you this Sunday, because I want you praying this week, God, what would you have me to do for Faith Promise for this coming year? And then we put all that together. And in fact, December we had a problem. You guys gave so much money last year, we had to add more missionaries. We added several missionaries in December. We gave like 6 or 8 or 10 raises because we needed to spend more money that you were, because we're not going to keep it here. We're not going to put gas in the bus and mow the grass. We're going to send it all out somewhere else. And so that was a good problem to have. Give us more problems this year, okay? That's what we're saying. And we like those kind of problems. We need to spend more money. And so we love doing that. So that'll be coming up next Sunday. So grab one of those flyers if that's all new to you. And we'll explain that a little bit better next week. But that's kind of the quick sketch over that. Also, next Sunday night at 5 o'clock, we'll be having a meeting in the cafe. We're going to Guatemala this fall in October. And so the ladies have been to Guatemala before. We've had men have been to Nicaragua, a couple of youth trips to Nicaragua. This is going to be men and ladies both involved. And we're doing that in October. So there's flyers in the back. Hey, easy on the banner over there, right, Chris? These guys are really into the missions this month. Sorry about that. You can just, Emily's going to come rescue to the rescue over there. So what was I even talking about? If you can't see from the back, the banner just fell on the youth group. So Guatemala, thank you very much. So next Sunday, 5 o'clock, this is an informational meeting. You don't even know if you want to go, but just come and show up, and we're going to talk about what we're doing. Part of it's going to be physical labor. If you want to be part of that half of the team, I'm going to go do some things. And then part of it will be like ministry to kids, VBS, school kids crusade type stuff. And so that way couples can go, men and women both, and I think 16 and up. And so it's going to be great. So we're just going to talk about that kind of informational meeting next Sunday night. We got a lot of time to prepare, but what's that look like? What are you going to ask me? What do I have to do? What do I not have to do? So that's next Sunday night on our World Missions Sunday. So lots of good stuff coming up. So sorry for all those announcements, but it's just a lot going on this month. Lots of good stuff going on, so we're excited about that. So we've done home missions. We've done world missions next week. And so these local missions, we like to take a Sunday and just, okay, it's nice to have the guy from Africa come, but what can I be doing in Sycamore and DeKalb? And Teen Challenge is great down in Peoria, but what could I be doing? So we try to give you options like Meals on Wheels, like Network of Nations dinner and stuff like that. And so we've had We Care Pregnancy Center, the guy from the truck stop in Rochelle that has a chapel, he's come on our local missions week. And so this week, if you remember last year, Roe v. Wade was overturned at the Supreme Court. And so that got a lot of people excited. We still lived in Illinois, so that didn't change much. But when you talk about sanctity of life, it's more than just I hate abortion. It's womb to the tomb, right? It's all of that. And so within the foster care system or kids without families or in troubled families through all of their teen years and through their younger years, how can we minister to them? God created them, and they live among us, and so how can we be a blessing to them? And so kind of our local missions emphasis this year is on rural kids camp and foster care. And so we had a great first service in Sunday school. John Swider is with us today. He was used to be the children's pastor at Stone Church, the great Stone Church of Chicago, one of our founding churches at Pentecost. And he's been involved with Royal Kids Camp for years. and a great brother in the Lord. And so they've come out to tell us what God's doing in foster care and with foster kids.
All right. Thank you, Pastor. I was telling the first service that you have a pretty brave pastor here bringing a guy into his pulpit that he's never heard speak before. So thank you, Pastor, for your bravery. Okay. Oh, that's right. It's all on YouTube. I forgot. Royal Family Kids is a one-week summer camp designed specifically for foster children. All the things that go on are with the within mind that every child that comes to that camp has been traumatized in some way. And so the camp experience that we have is very small. If you go to Carlinville Kids Camp, there's hundreds of kids there. Royal Family, 20, 30. If you're Willow Creek, 100. But it's not a lot of kids. And it's really two counselors to one kid, so it's very one-on-one attention. And notice there's some young people in here today. Royal Family Kids will also allow some 16, 17-year-olds to come to do things at camp that are not really counseling the kids, doing chapel, helping with the pool, things like that. But you got to be really mature, so because there's a lot of freedom at camp, and I know that knocks a lot of kids out, but every camp is different. And if you want to get involved in a Royal Family Kids camp, grab one of my cards, look online. It'll show you where the camps are in your area, and if you want to jump on board, please feel free. In this area right here, there's a church down the street called Glad Tidings, and Brandon Arneson would really like to start a ministry to foster kids that's not a summer camp. It's called Group Mentoring. Group mentoring is an opportunity for foster parents to bring their kids to church on a Saturday morning, just once a month for a little three-hour event, and it involves doing a puppet show, Bible story, some fast-action songs, do an activity, and then Connection Corner. And Connection Corner is where kids get to meet people like you and not only find out there's good people in the world, but find out that there are people who love them. And this might sound a little overwhelming to you, spending a week with a foster kid or even a Saturday morning. So let me ask you a question. How does God call the best out of us? What are the skills, the abilities, the things that are inside you that have yet to manifest? And it seems to me that they are more likely to rise when your natural abilities are inadequate to meet a challenge. In this business of advancing the kingdom, there's a cooperation between the spirit of us and the spirit of God. Both are inside, and as long as you can handle it, go for it. If you've got all the skills, abilities, and natural wherewithal to make this happen, go make it happen. But it seems to me that God wants us to depend on him, and where those natural abilities end, God's like, okay, I got this. Trust me, I'll get you through the rest of it. And it is at that place where God's desires are met, and it's the place where things get painfully fun. Yeah, I made that up. Now, generally speaking, we live pretty comfortable lives here in America, right? We got furnaces to heat our houses in the winter and cool in the summer. And it doesn't mean life is easy. It just means we have a lot of comfort. For example, I don't know how many of you walked to church today, but when I saw all the cars around the church, I thought probably most of you kind of drove here today, right? And I imagine most of your cars have working heaters, right? And I suppose that even some of you probably pushed the button from the kitchen. You know, so your only level of discomfort was from the kitchen door to the car and then from the car back into the church. Now, suppose you were driving out in the country and you hit some black ice and you spun off into a ditch, and you had to get out of your car and start walking. That's when you find out what uncomfortable really means, when you're trudging through the snow trying to get somewhere. Now, getting uncomfortable is where our limits are tested. It's where we find the courage and determination that we didn't know we had. On the other hand, alternatively, it gives us reason to quit. Well, I don't want to do that. That makes me uncomfortable. In either case, what's deep inside comes to the surface. Whether inside is victor or victim, it comes to the surface. I've got a friend, Pastor Brian, in the Rockford area, and his school started allowing boys to shower with the girls. He pulled his two girls out of high school. He went to the next board meeting and declared war. And now he has 60 parents in his group that are strategizing to learn, how do we run for board? How do we make a difference in our community? And none of those people probably ever thought about doing that until things got uncomfortable. So I'm going to use the beginning of the Sermon on the Mount today as a launching point. It's found in Matthew chapter 5. Every verse in that is a sermon in itself. They're so fully packed that they're bottomless. It seems that the more you dig into these, the more you find out that there's more underneath. So let's begin. Seeing the crowds, he went up on the mountain, and when he sat down, his disciples came to him, and he opened his mouth and taught them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied. Blessed are the merciful, they shall receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, they shall be called the sons of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when others revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice, be glad, for your reward is great in heaven, for so they persecuted the prophets who were before you." Jesus opens this sermon with, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." That phrase has enough specificity that we know what Jesus is talking about, but there's enough ambiguity to incite our imagination. Who are these poor in spirit? Now, Webster has defined poor as lacking sufficient money to live at a standard considered comfortable in society. Jesus was not talking about that. He was not talking about living conditions. He's talking about who is poor in spirit. On the Mount, he's addressing people that are in need of something. They are deficient. They are poor in spirit, and they came knowing he had something that they lacked. I went on Google Maps and I looked up the Chorazin Plateau, where they believe that's where the Sermon on the Mount was. And on Google Maps, it tells you how to get there. Get this. This site can be reached via Route 90, a steep road that climbs up from the Sea of Galilee from the Tabkha Junction. From Tel Aviv, there are regular trains to Tiberias Central Station, and from there, you can take a bus. However, if you are walking, the closest town is Capernaum, 3 hours uphill from there. If you were coming from Tiberias, it was going to be a 5-hour walk all uphill. Every hearer that day had to decide they were going to push through their personal comfort of staying home to go receive what they lacked. Jesus was surrounded by the poor in spirit, and he offered them the kingdom. I'm going to be introducing you to Christina Engel. She is a public service administrator for the Aurora Field Office of Illinois Department of Children and Family Services. Christina serves the children with tenacity and with passion. And it is my firm belief that, you can come up here, Steve, it is my firm belief that we are called to serve the orphan. In fact, James 1:27 says that is pure religion, to come to the aid of the orphans in their distress. So Christina's life is dedicated to helping the orphans in their hardships, and she cannot do her job with people saying yes to come alongside. Christina?
Thank you. First and foremost, thank you for your lovely welcome here. I'm very humbled by it, and it's really brought some peace to me this week, so I thank you for that. The music ministry, lovely, lovely, lovely. So why do you want to be a foster parent? Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth, correct? We need people to help the meek. We need people that support children. We need people that support their families. When their birth families cannot manage it, we need people to step in and be that community. So why be a foster parent? First and foremost, you influence a child's life. But not only do you influence their life, they will influence your life. I promise you that. It's part of being part of the community. You support them. You support a solid community, correct? You can mentor people. You can provide respite for people. Any little thing that you can give. And again, it's not about finances. It's about giving out of your heart. And it's about fulfilling that poorness in yourself by giving to others. We find that when foster kids have done volunteer work, for example, all of a sudden it's not so much about themselves and it's about serving others. You're serving your community, you're serving your family, but most of all, you're serving God.
This picture up here is a lady named Holly. She has served our Royal Family Kids Camp for almost 20 years. We had a young girl come to our camp at age 11, and our camp is from 6 to 11 years old. It was her first time there. And when we found out the tragedy that she came through which she came to us, she was in the same foster home from birth all the way to 11 years of age. Her foster father tragically died, and mom could no longer handle life and could not handle the child anymore. And so this girl at the age of 11 went into the foster care system for the first time. When she was graduating Royal Family Kids, Holly decided that this young lady needed a mentor, needed someone to be consistent in her life. And so Holly would pick her up at her foster home on weekends and just take her out to lunch and spend time with her. And that became a pattern for the next 4 years. Because this young girl was available for adoption, she went into a home with the intention of adopting, but it didn't work out, and she went back in the system. And then she finally got to a home where today she is adopted. But through those 4 years of chaos, she had one consistent relationship in her life that made all the difference.
Absolutely. Next slide, please. Foster parents, you're unrelated to children that come into your home. That's what a traditional fostering family is. And again, you're opening your home, you're opening your heart. So this has to be a decision between partners, couples, as well as the rest of your family. Because I will tell you, the kids in partnership with their parents are what make our fostering family so strong. They're the ones that are doing a lot of the heavy lifting. You may be doing the parenting, but they're doing the mentoring, the support, the sharing the toys, the sharing the bedrooms sometimes. So it's so important to understand this is a family commitment as well as your community commitment.
Kyle and Tina just got married, and they were married for about 5 years and found out they couldn't have kids. And they were in a service much like this, and they felt God calling them to be foster parents. And so they went through the process. They got licensed, and within a very short period of time of getting licensed, they took in three teenagers into their home. Now, these three kids were not much younger than Kyle and Tina were. But this young man, Carlos, I met him a year later. I was back at that church, and the pastor said, "You need to go talk to Carlos after the service." And so I walked up to this big Puerto Rican kid. I'm looking up at him, and I said, "Carlos, Nick told me to ask you what's new in your life." Carlos was fighting back tears. He said, "You know, I've never known a life without violence." This young man went into foster care at the age of 17. And he said when he came into Kyle and Tina's house, he said, "They love me. They bring me to this church. Everyone here loves me." The impact that one person can have on the life of a child is generational. Now that Carlos is married and has a kid, he still calls Kyle and Tina mom and dad after only being in their house for a year. And that's where he goes for Thanksgiving, birthdays, and Christmas.
One of my favorite foster stories is that I had a couple, and they wanted a baby. So we were able to place a baby in their home, and then all of a sudden grandparents came forward and they wanted that baby back. So we were able to go ahead and transition the baby to their grandparents where they should be, and that was okay. I remember the couple going, "I don't know if we can do this. This is so hard." And all I said to them was, "Please, hang in there with me. This happened for a reason. I want you to believe that. I believe that a lot of things happen for a reason." So then we were able, within a couple weeks, we placed another baby in that home. And that baby had siblings. And two of the older kids were in another one of my foster homes, and that wasn't working out real well. So I asked them if they would take those two kids. And they did. So now they had three under the age of five. They were a little overwhelmed because they didn't have any kids. Everything's going along. Parents aren't getting themselves together, unfortunately, so they weren't going to go home. There were two older siblings that were with grandparents initially, because the grandparents could manage the older ones but not the babies, right? So the grandparents were like, we want to be grandparents. We don't want to be parents anymore. So we talked to this couple, and they took the two older kids. So now they went from I want a baby to five kids. And grandparents got to remain grandparents, and they've maintained that relationship, which is so important for these kids to know where they come from and to have those supports. And the beauty is, every year at the holidays, I get a card from them. And the card shows the kids in their birth order, riding bikes or walking to school or whatever. And again, they weren't cut out from their family. They had a family that enhanced them and support them. One has a driver's license now. They're looking at trade schools and colleges now. It is amazing what the foundational family can do for our kids that have come into care. Let's talk about fictive kin. Fictive kin is very important to all of you here, because what a fictive kin person is someone who has a relationship with the child, not always the parents, but with the child. One of my foster families, he was a coach at the local high school in my area, and he was aware of a kid coming into care, and he's like, I know that kid. I don't want him to go somewhere else. He's on my team. I need him on my team. And they decided to foster this kiddo. And it was a big step for them, because they were like, oh, we want babies. Well, they ended up with a teenager in their home. It was so good for him. He didn't leave his school. He didn't leave his community. He didn't leave his family. He got to stay on the basketball team. And that was what was so important for him. And they nurtured him, and he coached him, and he mentored him more so than hard fathering him. Does that make sense? So when we have that relationship with kids, they need to go somewhere where they're comfortable. And that's what is so nice about Royal Family Kids Camp. They go somewhere where they're safe and comfortable. And then again, our relative fostering families, grandparents, aunties, uncles. I had one grandma who left Michigan and got an apartment here so she could take care of her child, her grandchild, so that grandchild wouldn't go into an unknown home. It happens. It's unfortunate, but it happens.
This photograph here is from one of our chapters down in Bethel. Pastor Eric and Bethany Scottberg are part of our Royal Family Kids Camp down there. They host it at their church, and they got a call from social services that one of their campers' placement failed, and could they come live with them? And they opened up their home to this child. They got them reconnected to her camp counselor, and now they're in the process of adoption.
That's amazing. These are good stories. Yeah. These are good stories. So what can you do if you don't want to be a foster parent? Because it is a big step. It's not for everybody. It's the hardest job you'll ever love, is what I like to say about it, just like parenting is, right? You can provide respite care. Can you do that? Can you give an hour or two of your time if you know a family is in need? And not just for foster kids, for any family. Sometimes mom or dad need a break. They need to be able to go to medical appointments or take care of some laundry or just need, you know, a bathtub time. Respite care is so helpful. Invite kids over for play dates so they have nice interactions with other kids. Or if someone wants to come to church, be the person that will watch the kids so they can come to church. You can bring foster family hard goods. For example, when someone gets a new placement in their home, they may not have clothing for that child. Many of our kids don't come with a lot of clothing because we've taken them out of bad situations and put them in the car, and here we come. So whether it's diapers, whether it's formula, whether your child has maybe outgrown some clothes and they're in perfect condition and you want to move them along, please feel free to do that. So that's very, very helpful. Individualize this. We don't need to make everything about, we have to build a system. Build your own support system. That's what families need. just like any family in need in your worship community. Transportation. Gosh, how many times? Wouldn't it be nice if we just had someone else that would help do the, you know, transporting kids to and from practices, a pickup at school, or whatever you need to do, or someone has to go to a visit. Foster mom has to take a child to a visit, but the other kids need to get to practice. Those are some nice, soft services and supports that make all the difference in the world for success. For example, I have a foster mother. She'll take two real high-end teenagers for me. She needs someone in the home when she goes to work before they get on the school bus. She just needs some eyes and ears. So wouldn't that be nice to be able to give those kids an hour a day just to make sure they eat the breakfast, they got everything to get on the bus? Those little things mean a lot to people. Next slide, please. Statewide picture is a little grim. I'm trying to be a little bit more sunny on this this go-round. But the statewide picture, the numbers speak for itself. In 2019, we had 16,565 kids in care in the state of Illinois. That's just in the state of Illinois. Now we have well over 20,000 kids in care in 2 years. Our resources are getting so tapped. They're tapped. We have so many kids coming to care. We need providers. It's been rough. I'm not going to lie. It's been rough.
Give us a snapshot of
119 kids out of DeKalb County alone have come into foster care. We have 62 of them with relatives. We have 53 of them with traditional foster parents. Relatives could be fictive kin or regular relative homes. In DeKalb County with DCFS, and this is in all our private agencies, we have 21 foster homes in all of DeKalb County. We have only three that have openings. Three. And then we don't even know if they'll take the kids that need to come into care. What happens when we can't place kids in their area? They get placed in other homes. In other places. They could end up in Rockford. They could end up in DuPage County. Let's think about that again. You lose your family, you lose your pets, you lose your school, you lose your sports because we cannot keep them in the area. It is so important. You lose your church community. It is so important for kids to stay in their neighborhoods.
Thank you, Christina. Now, she's going to be at her table at the end. If you have any questions at all, she is the person to talk to. Now, let me tell you about some of the kids that came to our camp. Kimmy came to our camp way back in 2005. And when Kimmy came to our camp, we thought she was in a good foster home, that everything was going well for her because she was so easy. A lot of foster kids aren't easy because they come to camp and they act out their survival skills. And we didn't recognize that in Kimmy, that her survival skill was compliance. Whatever, tell me what to do and I'll do it. Just don't abuse me. Just don't kick me out. Well, when she came back at 16, we learned more about her life because we were grilling out our first day of camp, and Kimmy got her plate of food and she came and sat by me, and we're at the campground that she was at as a kid. And I probed a little bit, and I said, Kimmy, you were here as a little kid, now you're here as teen staff. What are you thinking? And I watched her eyes turn red, and she put her plate of food down, and she walked away from me. We have rules at camp, women with girls, men with boys, so I couldn't go after her, but a support staff went after her. And she encouraged her to write me a letter about what was going on in her life. As I'm reading that letter that night, she said, it wasn't anything you said that made me cry. As I sat there, I realized that my only happy childhood memories happened here. And then we found out that she wasn't in a great foster home. She was placed with an alcoholic uncle. And she wasn't getting along with her siblings because all five kids went with the uncle. And so the oldest brother, James, had to go to a different foster home, and he got killed in a car accident. And Kimmy felt that was her fault. And then her older brother, Ricky, had to be institutionalized, and Kimmy felt that was her fault. And so she had one brother left, Timmy, that was younger than her. And so she did not report her uncle's abuse because they would take her away from her last brother. And so for 51 weeks a year, she was worthless and stupid, and 1 week a year, she was honored and treasured and valued, and it changed her life. when Kimmy came back at 16, she got involved with the local church. She accepted Christ. All this, her whole life began to turn around. And this photograph is of her being our assistant director a few years back because she was going to start her own camp. And she was our very first. We've been doing Royal Family Kids Camps for 30 years nationwide. She is our first former camper that is now directing her own camp. Lexi was a camper in Lincoln, Nebraska. And she was in a really good foster home. Her foster home was actually a children's pastor in town. But her experience in her home of origin, her birth home, was very traumatic because mom kept having boyfriends come in the house, and they would abuse Lexi. And when the boyfriend faced charges, mom would go through a program. Lexi would come back in the house, get a new boyfriend. And that cycle continued until mom lost her parental rights. And then Lexi came to Royal Family Kids Camp, where her foster mom was a volunteer. And at that camp, they had a princess day. And they got all the girls dressed up with pearls and a flower and an evening gown. They got their hair done. And a guy brought his Mustang convertible out to camp. And each one of the girls got to sit on the boot and do the princess wave while everyone cheered the princess. Nobody knew at that camp that that moment changed Lexi's life. Because she got adopted after camp. And when her adopted father began to abuse her, she would tell herself, "I am a princess. God did not create me for this." And then when that came to light, when he faced charges and that adoption failed, she went back in the foster care system. Now she's 15. And one of the judges of Chamberlain County got involved in her case. And he asked Lexi, "Have you ever had a positive experience in foster care?" And she said, "Yeah, I went to this camp where my foster mom served." And the judge is like, "What's her name?" Calls her up. By then she had moved from Lincoln, Nebraska to Sioux Falls, South Dakota. And he called Kathy Jo up and said, "Would you adopt Lexi?" She goes, "In a heartbeat." So Lexi moves to South Dakota. I come up to South Dakota to start camps. Kathy Jo and Lexi start our first camp in South Dakota. And 3 years later, I was visiting them at their camp, and now Lexi's 18. And I asked her, "Lexi, what are you going to do now? You're 18. You can do anything you want. What's going on?" And she said, "Well, I want to go to ministry school, but we can't afford it. So I'm going to community college." And I remember riding away from that camp on my Harley thinking, what a waste, you know. Community college is great if you're going into business or if you need to get your general ed out of the way. All those great things about community college are great unless you're going into ministry. And so 3 weeks later, I'm in a suburb of Atlanta, Georgia, down in Griffin. And I'm at a big conference, big Sunday school conference. I'm promoting Royal Family Kids Camp. And I look behind my table at the cafe, and there's the senior pastor of the church, Randy Valamont, big church of 4,000, the school administrator, one of my major donors. So I went around to the cafe, and I said, "Randy, what can I do to get one of my campers here in your school?" He says, "What's her story?" I tell him the princess story. A little tear leaks out of Randy's eye. He goes, "You know, I was adopted." And he starts telling me of his adoption story and how that led to his salvation and eventually pastoring one of the largest churches in Georgia. And after that conversation, he said, "John, I'll tell you this. If that little girl come to my school, I'll give $1,000 toward her tuition." My donor that was sitting with him said, "I'll match that, plus I'll fly her here on my airline points." The school administrator says, "We got that scholarship from Southeastern." Randy goes, "Let's give that to Lexi." So in 5 minutes, this girl got a 4-year free ride scholarship that she's praying about 2,500 miles away. Yeah, you can give Jesus a big hand for that. Here's the thing. That was Saturday. School started Monday. And I'm like, "Randy, she doesn't know I'm talking about her. She doesn't know any of this stuff is happening." And Randy said, "I'll tell you what, John, you get Kathy Jo on the phone and you tell her what just happened and then you tell her this. When Lexi can't get home for Thanksgiving, Christmas, summers, for the next 4 years, she is going to live in my house and she is going to be my daughter." That's a picture of Lexi graduating Bible college. What God can do in a child's life with the adults in their life that do the right thing is just, it's unimaginable on the front end. You can't see any of this on the front end. It's only in looking back. Becky came to our camp back in, 97. And Becky's experience was she lived in a very chaotic birth home. And there weren't any placements for her when she was put into the system at 9. She had to go right into a group home. And so in that group home is when she came to camp. And her positive memory was she met adults that did what they said. When we said we ate at noon, we ate at noon. When we said, we're going to go to the pool at 2 o'clock. We were there at 2 o'clock, and it just so surprised her that there were adults in this world that would do that. Well, Becky came to camp for 3 years, and Becky, if you're watching, I'm telling the story one more time. We have an area camp called Dress Up, and people give us costumes, and the kids wear costumes all day. Becky wore the wedding dress every day, and she married every boy in camp. She's 34 years old now. She hates that story. But one of our volunteers saw Becky in the wedding dress and just whispered a three-second prayer. And she said, "If God, if there's anything I can do to make that happen, let me know." And God called Shirley to be Becky's foster mom. And Becky moved in 3 blocks away from me, and I got to be her daddy for the next few years. The greatest moment of that story was when I got to do Becky's wedding 13 years later. And when her fiancé came to ask me if he could marry Becky, we talked for an hour before I said yes, because he had to know the history of her redemption and all the components that went into creating who this person was. And I have I have one more picture to show you. Check this out. This is the impact that you have on a child, and you go through all those difficult, traumatic things with them, and then God redeems them, and another generation begins to come from them. And Becky and little Georgie is never going to spend a day in foster care. Kimmy with little Sawyer is never going to spend a day in foster care. What I'm asking you to do today is to consider transforming the life of a child through one of the ways that we talked about today. And I want to pray for you. I want to pray that God would inspire each one of you to know what it is he wants you to do. Foster care isn't for everybody. Going to camp isn't for everybody. Mentoring a foster child isn't for everybody. But it's for somebody. It's for somebody. I don't believe your pastor would have called me here today if there wasn't somebody in here being called to do this. So I want to pray for you right now. Father God, thank you. Thank you that it is through your redemption and through your call that we can do anything. Father, as we attach ourselves to you and we know that outside of you we can do nothing, Father, what is it that you want us here in Bethel Church to do to help transform the life of a child and possibly every generation that follows that child? Father, we have to hear this from you because we can't just do that in our own strength. And Father, I also pray that you would help each one of us to know your will. If it's not this, Father, what is it? Because there is some way you want each one of us to advance your kingdom in this world. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. Pastor said he wants to take an offering for us. The offering goes to our parent organization called For the Children. For the Children runs Royal Family Kids Ministries. I travel around the country trying to get churches to start Royal Family Kids camps. I travel throughout Illinois to help churches recruit foster parents. So that's part of what I'm asking you to do, is helping me get to Philadelphia this year, help me to get to Massachusetts this year, help me to get to Kentucky this year. We have no camps in Kentucky, but I get to go to a minister's meeting there so we can present the ministry of Royal Family Kids. Pastor, thank you.
Thanks, John and Christina, for the great challenge today. And so here's how we're going to let you respond to that challenge. First of all, they'll be in the back. There's a table out in the foyer if you got more questions. John, what's the website for Royal Kids Camp?
RoyalChildren.org.
ForTheChildren.org. There we go. ForTheChildren.org. And you can go to the website if you want more information. He'll be in the back. They'll both be in the back if you want more questions you have, if you want to ask. A couple of different ways, like he said, Pastor Brandon over Glad Tidings, our sister church over in DeKalb, they have foster kids, they've adopted kids, and so if you have just like you want to like coffee, sit down, like nuts and bolts questions, he would love to get together with you. They'd like to start a mentoring group over there, and we'd love to partner with them in that. So if you want to go down that alley, there's a Royal Kids Camp in Geneva. It's probably the closest one to us physically. So if you're like, hey, maybe I could do that this summer. And maybe we're not ready to take on a whole camp all by ourselves, but one or two or three of you, we're going to team up with one in Geneva or maybe another one in the suburbs, kind of get your feet wet and kind of see what's going on without having to do everything. And that's a great way to start. You can find them on the website also, Find a Camp. And then like he just prayed for you. God, what would you have us to do? And is that an hour that you let somebody go take a break? Is it fostering? Is it being part of a camp? Or is it giving financially? Because we're going to take up an offering for the children on your way out. So on the back table, there's two baskets. And you can give online. Pastor Ethan can swipe your card. You can go online, just write Royal Kids Camp or Foster, and we'll make sure that gets in the right place. You can give online. Ethan can swipe your Pastor Ethan can swipe your card. We've got baskets in the back. If you're writing out a check, just make it out to Bethel Assembly God. We'll send them one check rather than 14 checks. Or if you just want to give cash today, or you can give next week if you didn't know what we were doing today. We'll send them. We'll wait a couple of weeks, let all that filter in, and we want to be a blessing to them. But so that we can multiply that and just keep spreading the love and the hope until Jesus comes. So that's what we're going to do. So why don't you stand? That way you can get to your wallet easier. And let's pray. Lord, we thank you, God, for what you're doing, bringing hope to broken lives and broken families. God, you're in the business of restoration, reconciliation, and adoption. And you adopted us as sons and daughters. So, God, we know exactly what we're talking about today. So, Lord, I pray for every one of us in this room. God, what would you have us to do? How can we be hands and feet? Is that through giving today? Is that through serving? God, it's different for every one of us in this room. And so, God, we're on the altar today. We're all yours. And so bless this offering. Bless these ministries. And as we bring health and wholeness in Jesus to broken kids. In Jesus' wonderful name we pray. Amen. Amen. Thanks for being here today. Pray about your faith promise for next week. Give on your way out. They're already at the back table, so they beat you there. If you got more questions, God bless you. Have a fantastic week. Sign up for Meals on Wheels. Lots of great ways to serve and to love. God bless you guys. We love you.